Good afternoon, everyone. I'm so sorry I kept you waiting. I was trying to do little work on the FB Live. Okay. So thank you so much for joining on time. And I can see so many chat messages here. So thank you so much for joining and accepting the invitation. Thank you so much, Mr. Arun, who mentioned my name. So you all are actually invited every day. For whoever is conducting the training or the session or, you know, sharing of knowledge that we are doing every day. So I love sitting here and listening to all of you. Today I steal a chance from the trainer and I thought, you know, because this is a topic which I actually love to discuss. And because we have many senior trainers, I have not planned any panel as of now. And I thought, okay, let's discuss this because we all know, I think most of us who are doing a training on soft skills or doing a sales training or maybe in other fields as well, we are speaking about Pareto's principle. And that says that Pareto's has various applications in various fields, in various departments. And that's where the thought has come in my mind that why not to discuss with all the experts in the group, all the members who have various experiences and understand that, maybe there are some unidentified area where also we can, you know, apply Pareto's principle. So that was the thought and I thought of doing this discussion today. So it's more of a discussion actually what I want to do. Maybe a little bit I will try and brief about this principle to everyone who have never used it or used it in a, you know, just allow me a second, please. And so I'm so sorry, someone at home. Okay, so yeah, so I thought of doing this today with all of you. And so yes, as I said that I have not planned any panel, but I want that all of us who are here, who joined for this particular discussion are quite interested in knowing about it and would like to contribute from your end. Maybe we will do a little bit of, brainstorming and understand that where all we can utilize this particular 80-20 principle in different trainings or in different genres, wherever we go and train people. So that is the thought behind it. So as I was saying that a little bit, I will speak about it and then we will go in discussion mode post that. So before directly getting into the Pareto's, I also want to discuss few more things. Before that, I also want to know that if you can use the chat box and write that what all trainings you are doing or what all fields you are taking the training. So whoever the trainers who are here, you are doing the trainings in different fields, maybe the sales, maybe into banking, maybe into insurance or any other sector. So if we can use the chat box and just tell me that what all you are. Yeah, so I've only seen one message, train the trainer, from Mr. Arun. No one else is doing any other training in the group today. If you want, you can unmute and say as well. As I gave you the example that we are doing sales training, we are doing training in automobiles, we are doing training in banking.
Hello?
Yes.
Hi.
Swati ji, Reena here.
Yes, Reena.
I do training into logistics, FMCG sales, soft skill, and retail.
Okay, okay.
And I'm working for Deendayal Gramin Kaushalya Vikas Yojana project actually in Assam.
Wow, so you are doing these multiple sectors, right?
Yes.
Okay, great. So we have Reena. Thank you so much, Reena.
Hello.
She is doing into FMCG. She is also having nursing.
Hello.
And all. One second. We'll just come to everyone one by one.
Yeah, Choudhury. I'm training the chartered accountant students. But so far as this application of is concerned,
sir, we are
I do not
you
apply mark. So I'm here as a learner. I would like to learn.
Okay.
Sorry, ma'am.
Okay, understood. Actually, your voice was in between. We are losing your voice, but we understood that you are here to learn about this particular thing.
More to learn.
Sure. Nikhil was saying something. Nikhil, now you can unmute. Yeah.
Yeah, this is Nikhil. Basically, I am indulged in sales training for automobiles and FMCD, that is LG Electronics. For automobile, I have done some trainings, particularly for John Deere and TAFE tractors. Besides that, I have also been engaged in numbers of banking training with Punjab National Bank, Axis Bank, Canada Bank, HDFC Bank. And apart from that, I have also been visiting the schools and that of the management institutes, particularly for digital transaction or digital payment solutions that is being conducted by NPCI, that is National Consumer Corporation of India.
Right. So basically your sectors are more of automobile banking, where you are giving, and also the little bit on chartered accountants and all. Okay, great, Nikhil. So we have other answers. Thank you so much, Nikhil. We have other answers like Ravi saying that he is doing IELTS. He also doing employability skills. Monali saying she's doing it for the budding trainers on soft skills, CS students, corporates as well, and etiquette. Vasudev sir is saying motivational and essential skills. Okay. Mr. Srimat is saying sales training, coaching, counseling. Someone is saying not audible. Am I not audible, Aisha? Okay, Shruti is saying corporate soft skill, NLP, life coaching. Okay, done. Okay, so many international batches also taken by Monali. All right, so its behavioral trainings are also there. Okay, now my second question is, who have used Pareto principle or 80-20 in their training till now, in any of your trainings? You just
this is Nikhil over here.
Yeah.
We have discussed or informed particularly to the participants in few of the banking training about 80-20 principles. So it was just a basic introduction that 80% of the people are engaged in just 20% of the work and 20% are doing almost 80% of the work. So how we can change this equation, or that is the thing that we have discussed particularly even in banking and FMCD training data of IG Electronics.
Thank you so much, Nikhil.
Hi, I'm Irene here.
Yes, Irene, please tell me.
I have imparted a Pareto training to participants who have attended my structured problem solving sessions, wherein one of the tools that we give them information on is the Pareto principle, and how do you use the Pareto to identify the problems that they should first tackle, so that 80% of their issues get resolved immediately. So I have used it in structured problem solving sessions.
Okay, great. Wow. Structural problem solving is one play location, like space set, I should say, we can use. So thank you so much, Aryan, for your input. We have Mr. Chaudhary, you want to say something?
Yes, ma'am. Basic training we give it, that 20% things needs to be solved because they are in the critical zone to get another 80% done. So that part we do it, and then we find out the possible cause and impact the programs. That much, and we haven't gone much deep inside it.
Okay. Thank you so much. Can we go to Mr. Arun? Yes, basis and
yeah, thank you, Swati. I use it for time management. I also use it for this thing, sales. So in sales, it is so popular that it is only your 20% customer will give you 80% business. So why waste time with others? And similarly, in time management, that if you check the productivity of your time, you will find that 80% of the time is giving only 20% result. So why waste time? So this way I use it. There may be other avenues also.
Sorry, by mistake, I mute myself. So I was saying that Mr. Arun said rightly that he has used it into the sales or customer service. But there are various other avenues where we can use it. That's why we are doing this discussion, that in what all areas you have, you know, already given a training. So that should be the first thing which should be clear to us, that these are some of my expertise or these are some of my areas where I am already giving the training. And if in case in future, if I want to give this particular training to my participants, how I can, you know, make, you know, use it as an application in that particular area. So I can see that people have written that the trainers are doing it in the NGOs also, in various other places, effective vocabulary, Monali's writing, sales time management, right? So, you know, so these are some of the areas who are into soft skill. They are doing all these trainings in various, you know, sectors and using the same principles in multiple ways. Now, let's first of all, before getting into a detail of, you know, Pareto's principles, I just want to discuss a little bit, a few more things with all of you. So the first thing is...
Can I say something? Hello? Am I audible?
Yes.
Okay. Hi. My name is Tarun. I have used 20-year Pareto principle for defect elimination. And so when you do, so Pareto is actually a part of 7 QC tools, which is widely used in the industry. Right. So what we do, how we use it, or what I have done is, so if there are 80% defects and the causes are 20%, if you take care of those 20% of causes, so you make a cause and effect diagram, which is also known as Ishikawa or a fishbone diagram. And then when you draw a Pareto against it, you get to know what are the major defect drivers, why you're getting so many defects. Okay. So for example, you follow 5M, couple of M's are like man, machine, mother nature, method. Now, if there is a process or there's an industry, whether it is service or whether it is manufacturing, you have only two options, whether you produce something or you give a service. And now there is a defect in a service or there's a defect in a product. So you try and figure it out. What are the major causes? Okay. So if there are 20% things which you take care of, your 80% of the problems are taken care of. So like Wilfred Pareto, who actually designed this, very rightly said that 20% people in the world, or 80% of the world's wealth, is possessed by 20% of the people. And that's what usually now happens, how things get impacted in economy and all. So if a lot of billionaires or people, those who are holding a lot of money in India, start moving to other countries, they start moving to Canada or Australia or something. So that is where the governments get concerned that why these people are going out. And that is where they come up with you know, schemes wherein to attract people or the rich people to come and invest in your country. So yes, 80-20 principle can be used every day, and from smallest of the things to maybe large industries.
Absolutely.
So classic example, if I correlate with training, so in training or in a classroom, there are 50 students, okay, and some of them are naughty. So there will be only two or three, those who are the naughty kids. Okay, you take care of them, the discipline is automatically maintained. I hope everybody will agree to that.
Absolutely, very true. Rightly said, Tarun. Thank you so much for your inputs and also sharing the application you have used in your session. Okay. So before we get into more discussion about Paretos, as I said, that I want to discuss a little bit more on something else. That is the question you can see on the screen. That is, what is something which motivates you, you know, as a person? What is something which motivates you? So I've just taken few examples over here. You know, if you go to self-serve restaurant, who will get your food to you? If it is a self-service restaurant, who gets food for you? You can write the answer in the chat box. Of course, self. We have to serve ourselves, right? We serve ourselves. We have to serve ourselves to get the food, right? Why we are, when we have multiple restaurants which are available where, you know, we get all these services, we don't have to go around. Still, we are going to, you know, going to such restaurants, these restaurants where you have to serve yourself. Why? What is the reason? What can be the reason? You can think of anything. We go to mall. There are so many stalls. We have number of options which are available. And we go to the counter, buy the food, wait for the food, take the token. And then we, you know, go and get our plates also by ourselves and search for the table. If we don't get the table, still we wait for the table and then we do, you know, we wait for that, right? Ultimately, what is something which is motivating is the taste of that food or maybe, you know, the service of that particular restaurant. Something is there which is motivating you to get the food and you are not worried about that whether there is someone who is going to serve you or not. So something in you, something about that particular food, something about that particular brand is motivating you to go and take the food from that particular counter. Of course. So Srimant is saying it's self-driven, we get choice. If anyone wants to give answer, I request, please follow the discipline what we follow. Raise your hand so that once I finish, I'll then give you chance to speak. There is an option of raise hand in your participants list below. If you raise in video, it will be difficult for me to check. Okay, Mr. Vasudev. Okay, there is an option which is raise hand. It's written below the participants, if you can check. If you do that, it will be easy somewhere for me to give the reaction. Chance. Yeah. Not reaction.
Somewhere it is written reaction.
No, sir. When you click on participants, there is a window open. Below that, you will see the raise hand option is there.
Because, I think I have raised now.
Yes, yes. Now you have done. Okay. Can I finish my these two points as well and then I come to you or you want to speak about restaurant only?
As you wish.
Okay, let me just finish these two and then I'll come to you, sir. So if a person is employed for self, who do they work for? It's of course working for themselves, right? If a person is employed for self, they are working for themselves. They are working for to fulfill their own responsibilities. They are working to fulfill, the goal of their life. And that's where they are putting in all the motivation is coming from self. And the third thing which I have written is these are few examples I have taken to achieve self goal, what is required. Of course, the motivation. The motivation is coming from some or the other reason, from some or the other places. And that's why we all are working. We all are running around. We all are putting in efforts in our life, right? Yes, Mr. Vasudev, you want to say something and then I move on to my point.
Madam, one time, what compromise we are doing on to having a self-service, mm-hmm. One is that we are getting quality food from that restaurant.
Right.
On the other way, this is from our end. If you look at the organizer who has put up this self-service restaurant, he wants to reduce the overheads of the waiters.
Mm-hmm.
He do not want to have the additional waiters to serve the people. So that he is reducing his overhead as such.
Right. So that is the other other point of view from the side of
our
the
restaurant.
Yes, the perspective. Yes. It's like, you know, they are doing, they are giving this service. They are saying that if I provide the quality meal to the people, I, even if I compromise on some of the services, the people are going to come and you know, take the food from me. So he is working more on the qualitative part of the food, or maybe the qualitative part of a service, or maybe maintaining the cleanliness, and what all people are actually looking for, and they are ready to, you know, take a food because the food is clean, food is tasty, they are you know, maintaining the cleanliness and hygiene and all that stuff. So that's why people are going to their restaurants and taking it. So this is, these are only few examples that whatever we do for ourselves, you know, there is some reason, there is some motivation behind that particular action what we do, right? For that, there is a theory which is known as self-determination theory, which is directly connected to the motivation of whatever work we are doing. Okay, self-determination theory is SBT theory. SBT theory says that every human being requires these three very, you know, a fundamental things which is required by every human being. The three things are competence, autonomy, and relatedness. What is competence? Every human being, every one of us are having some kind of a skill. We are having mastery on something or the other. And regularly also we are learning so many things and we have competence. So since childhood we have certain things we develop when we grow, and slowly our skills also get developed. Second thing I am talking about is autonomy. Autonomy is a control on your own life, your own independence, in a single word if I say, your independence is very, very much requirement. It's very much required for every human being. And third thing is relatedness. If I have the skills, if I have independence, and I am not knowing that where I am going to connect my, you know, my skills, then that relatedness is, if it's not there, then I am going to be the ideal person, right? So if, this is given, this is a research which is given by, you can see the name below, Mr. Edward Desai and Richard Ryan, which is very, very true. If you connect it with yourself, I'll show you the next image which shows you that, you know, how all the three things are very much connected to each other. So when, if you have independence, you can see that intersection over here. If you are independent, you have independence, you have a skill, but you are not having relatedness where to use it, then you are aimless. If you have a competence, you have a skill, you have a relatedness, but you are not having independence, it means you are not able to engage your skills. This means you are a disengaged person. If you have a relatedness and independence but no skills, then you are an ineffective person, right? So having all the three is very, very important, and then only any human being is an engaged citizen and will be a self-motivated person and self-determined to do something in their life. And that's why when we talk about efficiency, there are many, many programs we do where we, you know, we talk about efficiency and why you have to be efficient, and we speak to the employees, we go to the factories and we tell them that, you know, this is efficiency, that is efficiency. And we also talk about 80-20 Pareto's principle. But sometimes we miss on telling them that you have to use your all the three things which is available to, with you, but you, why you are feeling that you are not that engaged. That is something which we have to identify. And once you know that, you know, why I have to be engaged, then you can, you know, that your self-determination or your democracy or your, you know, independence, how you, it should be well used in your life, in your professional and personal life, then only you can utilize the principle which we are going to talk about. So I always use this and help them first understand that, you know, self-determination is something which ensures your democracy. You have to be self-determined first, and then move on to anything you are doing in your life, which is very, very important. So any questions in this slide? Anyone? Okay, so I can see one no here. All right, it's very simple. There's nothing in that, but this needs a little bit of connection with whichever, you know, whoever is your participant, you need to just connect with their background, with their and it's something which is like related to a human being actually. So you know, so it's for each one of us, not only for the employees, it's for each one of us. A little brief about Pareto's 80-20 principle, who have not used it or not read about it. So a little bit, Tarun has spoken about that. So, you know, a little introduction I will give to you. So Pareto's analysis is a statistical technique. It is a decision-making, you know, used for selection of a limited number of tasks that produce significant overall effect, right? To get an overall effect or to take a decision in any of the fields, we sometimes use 80-20 principle in various aspects of our life, right? And it is given by in late 1940s. There is a Romanian-born American engineer and a management consultant. His name was Joseph M. Zuren, who suggested this principle. But later it is named by Italian economist Wilfred Pareto, who observed that 80% of income in Italy went to 20% of the population. And Pareto later carried out surveys in some other countries and found to his surprise that similar distribution is applied in many other cases. And that's why he came up with this particular principle. He checked that what are the different applications of the Pareto's principle in our day-to-day life, in our workplace, in our personal life as well. And he came up with this particular, you know, equation and spoke about it. And then the other people accepted it. And that's how the principle came into application in various other sectors. Right? So so basically we say that, you know, so the 80-20 ratio of is the cause to effect, like, you know, 80%, I'm so sorry, 1 second. Yeah.
Ma'am, there is some black colored.
Yes, I'm just trying to close that one.
Yeah.
Okay. So as you can see here, he observed that 80% of, like, you know, just taking one of the examples, he observed that 80% of peas in his garden came from the 20% of the pea plant. And this is a very general, a regular process. We also do, we also maintain various, you know, planters, or, you know, we do that. And what we are using is a seed. And with the same seed, there are, you know, number of plants which come in after some time. So that is what he, you know, observed. That 80% of the peas in his garden came from 20% of the pea plant, or 80-20 ratio of cause to effect became known as Pareto's principle. So it is basically, there are some, like Tarun also mentioned, there is a cause which gives some kind of an effect. So 80%, 20%, in that way, the calculation has come in picture. The meaning of Pareto's principle, you can always read out on the side which I have written. This is also known as, or it is famous in 80-20, by the name of 80-20 rule. And theory is saying, talking about 80% of the output from a given situation or the system is determined by the 20% of the input, right? So it's not exactly same, but then this is how basically the situations, or it's a precise ratio which they have demonstrated in most of the situations. It works in similar way. And that's how, if you can see the image, if you, they are saying that we always work on 20% of effort. If your 20% of effort is going to give you 80% of results, so why not to work in that area where you have to put in little effort but you get 80% of results? But there is a contradiction also in this particular theory, which we are going to discuss little later when we went into little discussion mode about this. So today, I have not brought the chart over here. Yes, I know there is a chart of that. But because we are here in little bit of in general discussion where I have not chosen anything, but I'll try and explain it over here. If possible, someone raise the hand also in between. Yes, Mr. Vasudev, you raised your hand.
Now, no worry, I got understood because I was confused somewhere, but I understood now.
Okay. Okay. This is a brief about that how principal has come in and it's on by whom, name and all that. Now we can discuss, we can, you know, get into little discussion mode that how we can apply this principle in various training aspects of in various sectors in which we are giving training. Tarun has explained it that in the classroom, if we are, you know, going to manage with, two or three who are the notorious, participants in the class, then the rest class will definitely get managed by themselves. So that is one of the very simple example for the trainers or the teachers who are there. So do you all agree to this? If you are in the class, if you have someone who is, you know, creating some kind of a nuisance or they are notorious or interfering you at times, if you able to manage those participants, you able to manage the entire class very easily. Do you feel that that's a correct input which has come from Tarun's side?
Yes, madam. I have also experienced that.
Okay. Okay, anyone else?
Yes, that is of course right. Even in our training methodologies also, we use this principle. No? The one of the best principle that almost all the trainers they use in their sessions is like, you know, the most of the time it will be a Q&A session. Right? Where the effort of the trainer is 20%. He or she will be only in the mode of asking the questions. And 80% of the effort is put by the students or the participants where they give different answers for one particular question. Where a student or a participant can learn more wider angle of an answer for a particular question or a particular skill. This is where this Pareto principle is also used while we induct training or if you are teaching something.
Absolutely. So there are multiple, now see, it's coming from your end only. There are multiple ways of using the principle, right? So as I have asked all of you that, you know, you all are giving trainings in multiple sectors, multiple, you know, departments, reaching to multiple type of a people. Okay, I have a raised hand from Nikhil. Yes, Nikhil. Nikhil, you can unmute and speak.
Most of the time, while we are inducting or giving training to someone or a group of people, it's we used to observe that to only 20% of the people are showing their activity, higher activity or proactive approach. So for involving the rest of the team member, or better to say the participant, we can sort it out, the 20% to a single side. And we will focus so we can have a more participative approach, particularly while extending a training.
Absolutely. And what you mentioned, Nikhil, is actually, I think we observe it every day. Like yesterday only, I was taking a session of almost 60 employees who were there virtually connected. And, initially it becomes, difficult. Because most of the sessions I take, I want to interact with the participants, and that's how I plan the session also all the time. And initially, it is a little difficult to ask them to write in the chat box. They feel a little lethargic in writing. And then, you have to again and again call them. So initially, what I always do is start with some kind of a fun activity which engage them. And usually, I start getting the answers in that, first 10-15 minutes only. They become little free in discussing. Even if they don't unmute, sometimes they keep on writing in the chat box. And that helps because there are few answers which starts coming. The others also start, writing the answers because they also start getting involved. And there is a different kind of a healthy, answering competition which starts, because then we start taking the name of a person, we start thanking them, you know, thank you for doing this, thank you for writing, and everyone would like to, you know, okay, so now because they are getting appreciated or they are getting we are paying gratitude to them, so others also start involving themselves in the session. That absolutely correct, that helps and that happens. Yeah.
There is approximately 20% that we are talking about disturbing elements. I found more or less they are activity oriented. They want activities to be done very frequently in the class. So for them, at least I have seen that not very frequently, but maybe after 1 hour, if you can do some activities, they keep quiet.
Yeah. So if you get again, it is applicable to the time also, Mr. Chaudhary and everyone. Now we are saying it's not only the number of participants; it's also the time. Like, you know, if you have 100% time, now the principle goes in the other direction, that you have to utilize your 20% time in engagement and 80%. So there also it comes in the picture, like how you are going to use your 80-20 principle in this engagement part. Right? If we give our 80% of session only in engaging, then what will happen? Half of the time they are only busy in doing something else and we lose on them. So there also the application comes in picture. Yes, Monali, you raised your hand first. We come to Mr. Vasudev after that. Monali?
Yes. For Monali to speak.
Monali, am I audible? Okay, let her come back. You can speak by the time, Mr. Vasudev.
Ma'am, shall I go with?
Yes, please.
It was an answer to someone's you know, query. Normally, my practice and the learning journey which I started in 2010, it was also my analysis that we every 45 to 1 hour, we need to put up some sort of energizer activity, games, or something interpersonal sort of you know, interaction. Because even in our school days, if you remember, we have the classes or a single period is of 45 minutes. And 40 and 45 minutes, it is at the world level, it is being, you know, analyzed that after 40, 45 minutes, your computer gets slow. So you need to restart this computer. So to restart this computer, these are the activities what we follow normally in the training session on the ground. And equally, into this, I'm into webinars which I'm delivering personally. I put up some sort of, you know, interactive question, maybe 5 minutes, and because this is online, we cannot consume much more time. But activity goes with maybe 20 minutes, 30 minutes. And my practice normally with the corporates is nothing but I go with immediately after activity, there's a tea break or something. So that the people are refreshed 100%, they want to chase the mobile, they want to reply somebody. So everything is, you know, combined in all. And this 80-20 principle, which I'm learning today, I haven't gone through yet. So it is an awesome journey with you. So 20% principle, I mean 20% efforts and having an outcome of 80% is my personal opinion that I go with. And it is practiced very well and giving awesome results. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for the input. Yes, Monali. Monali, am I audible? Please go ahead. I think she is facing some bandwidth issue. I can see some answers in the chat box as well. Soren is saying that 80-20 principle can effectively be used by the trainer in ADDIE model. Absolutely, by doing his analysis well, which will bring out the outcome of 80%. Likewise, in every other session. Absolutely correct, Aaron. Monali, are you there?
Am I audible now?
Yes, you are.
okay, I think my headphone was not working properly. Anyway, so I would like to just add something over here that even when we train students for appearing for interviews, this is what we generally tell them using the 80-20 principle is, you know, using 20% of effort in the beginning, that is how they create that first impression with their appearance and with, you know, the first impression is created mostly how you wish or greet and just start with the interview first. What usually happens with candidates is they use 80% of effort in using effective vocabulary and all that, and they try to concentrate more on that, and then they don't get results. Instead, we tell them to first concentrate on the 20% effort, which is, you know, related to their appearance and first impression, and then automatically, once the confidence becomes high, it is easy for them to attain that 80% to get through easily.
Absolutely. So the same thing can be used in the other way around. It's not always, 80-20. It can be 20-80 also at times. Right?
Yes.
Thank you so much for the input, right. Monali. I have seen, Tarun, your message just now that you want to explain it with some other example as well. So you are please, you can please unmute yourself and give another example what you want to give.
Okay, am I audible?
Yes, you are audible.
Okay, so on the slide also you have mentioned, so lot of our trainers, we guys, we do not give only one kind of training. We give multiple kind of training. Maybe it is soft skill, then there is behavior, then there could be a technical, there could be some niche segment which you do. Everyone would realize that their major revenues come from some specific set of training. So this is another example of an 80-20 principle. And that is when you start focusing on that particular subject only. Or say, let's go for two-wheelers. Let me take a very generic example. Everybody has heard about Hero. Hero, which make two-wheelers.
Yes.
Now, if they have got 10 different brands, right? They will have a scooter, they have a motorcycle, they have a sports motorcycle, they have a basic commuter bike. But if you will go and ask the top management that where do you get your maximum revenue, they will just tell you one or two models. So, for example, if I take 10 different models of Hero motorcycles, okay, they'll tell you only two or three models, for example, Splendor or some other, model, which gives them the 80% of the revenue or which is their cash cow. So, similarly, in trainings also, when we do our analysis, we can figure out that which particular training is giving me the maximum number of or the maximum revenue. That is where you cannot goof up. That becomes your core competency. I hope everybody agrees to that.
Yes, exactly. Even revenue generation for a trainer also in the same way. You see, your 80% of your revenue is generated from training the 20% of the corporates.
Yes, yes. So, for example, if you have got 10 clients, okay, but maximum you get it from one or two clients. Let me not name. So, we have, A1, A2, A3, A4, A5 till A10, you have got 10 clients. And, one client just gives you a training once in 2-3 months. There is another client which gives you, say, in 1 month, he gives you 2 or 3 trainings. And then there is another client who gives you a training every month, almost 5-6 days, okay? So, he is a major revenue generator for you. At any point of time or at any cost, will you goof up with that particular client? No, nobody can afford to do that. So those 20% are your critical ones. Okay. So that is what you call your critical clients or the 20% revenue generators or the 20% clients which give you the 80% of revenue.
80% of
that is where you need to focus. Now, same thing happens. For example, let me take you another example of a BPO industry. Okay, when they do the call analysis, the call drivers, whenever you call a bank or a credit card company, what are the maximum call drivers or call generators? Either you need to know the balance, or you have not received your statement, or you have not received the correct statement. So they figure it out what are the major defects. Or if Amazon, for example, somebody calling up Amazon, maximum number calls are coming to them because my product is not delivered on time and I'm doing a follow-up. So when they do a process improvement, they figure it out that my 80% calls or 80% defects are coming because products are not being delivered on time. So they need to work on those logistics. And if they are able to fix that 20% of the problem area, their 80% of the defects are taken care of. And that is how these companies work on the Six Sigma principle as well.
Sorry, you said that out of these 10 clients that you got to give training, two clients give you more revenue.
Correct.
And you cannot goof off.
Correct.
Can you afford to goof off another 8 also?
See, no. I cannot. Because I cannot.
You have to give...
No, hear me out. Hear me.
No, as a trainer,
let me finish. For me, all 10 clients are important and critical. But if I look at a business owner, those particular 2 or 3 clients are really critical. I cannot goof up because if I goof up with them, my whole company would go for a toss. So I'm not saying those remaining 7 or 8 are not important. Yes, they are important. But if I have to prioritize, because this is also used for prioritization. As I had said, there's a cause and effect diagram or a fishbone diagram. It always tells you, you will have to set your priorities. Right?
Actually, the exercise that we are doing at the moment, it is also a priority related. 80-20 is a priority related. But what I mean to say is, these 8 companies that we are talking about, we have to, of course, for 2 companies, you have to give extra care.
Correct.
I admit. But eight other companies, you cannot have a loose train.
No, I cannot have a train.
God forbids,
I have to cut short, or if I have to reduce my client, or if, you know, there are 2 clients, A and B. A gives me my 80% of the revenue or 60% of the revenue, and B just gives me my 10% of my revenue, and both of them want the same dates. Who would you say yes and who would you say no?
That is a different proposition altogether.
No. 80-20 principle talks about that priorities. I will have to say yes to A because he is giving my 60-70% of the revenue. I have to pay my employees. I have to pay my bills. I have to run my office. At no cost, I can disappoint that particular person. Because he will say, fine, yeah, if today you don't have time for me, Tarun, I might look for another trainer. So no, I give a priority to B. He gives me that 10% of the revenue. He's really happy. But that 10% of the revenue, is it going to help me to run my business and run my show?
No,
I'll be out of.
No, Tarun, if it is classes, the date classes, that's a different thing altogether. That's a different.
One more thing, Chaudhary, I would like to add on to you, Tarun, if you permit me.
Ravi sir, sure, why not? Please go ahead.
Yeah, okay. Tarun, it's like, see, when we are prioritizing those 2 or 3 customers from whom we are generating 80% of the income, we are not goofing up the rest of the 6 or 7 customers.
Exactly.
Right. Here, the thing is that even while prioritizing, also, you see, we cannot ask for a postponement or a rescheduling of a date with those customers, those who are giving us 80% of revenue.
Correct.
But at the same time, the rest of the 6 or 7 customers, those who are giving us only 10% or 15% of revenue, we can ask them for a reschedule, because even for them, 80% of the revenue is generated from us. Therefore,
Bang on. That is what I'm saying. So there's
they're really on us, so they are ready to give us a reschedule. Thereby, neither you are disappointing your 80% income customer nor the 20% income customer. This is very.
There is a step ahead of this.
I agree with you, Ravi sir. But when only classes.
Only when it clashes, you are right. But there is a step ahead. I am not very sure how many of you have used a Pareto chart. That is the reason I said if we have a Pareto chart, it will be able to explain you better. Once the Pareto chart is made, the next thing which is made is a priority matrix. And that goes to all the stakeholders that this is your priority matrix. So the term priority itself is self-explanatory, that if you have to prioritize, whether it is your day-to-day work, whether it is your client management, whether it is your family. So for example, someone is sick in the family and you have some office work, you need to figure it out what is more prior for you. You have to set your priorities. So once you have done your 80-20 principle, once you've done that analysis, the next thing the organization or your business owner will ask you to do is, okay, fine, now we have the data. We have done 80-20 principle. Please make a priority matrix. What are our business priorities? There are certain things. There's something known as a calculated risk. There are times when you have to let go business. There are times when there is an attrition. When, for example, you have got employees, there are 20% employees in the organization which are giving you 20% of the productivity, 80% of the productivity. And there are some people in the bell curve which are just not doing anything. They just come to office for the sake of attendance. And tomorrow, if you have to lose them, okay, there's no problem. And that is known as healthy attrition. Even if the HR comes and says that we are facing a high attrition, it's okay. Let these people go because it is good for the company. You're saving on the salaries because the 20% cream, which gives me the 80% of the revenue, needs to be retained. That is where the priority matrix will come into place. And you will figure out what are your priorities. So Chaudhary ji, you rightly said, yes, in a case of a clash. But even when...
Excuse me. Your you can give a better quality of training to these two clients.
That is where I beg to differ. The quality of training or the quality of product cannot be compromised. It is sacrosanct. Even if I have a client which gives me one training in 6 months, I will give him the same quality of training which I give it to my client which gives me month on month, say 10 days in a month. Quality is sacrosanct.
Exactly, Tarun. I would second you here.
However, if I have to say no to someone because of a clash, as you said, the guy who is giving me once in 6 months, I can tell him that, sir, right now I'm occupied. However, what I will do is I can give you next week or a week prior to this, but this particular days are blocked in my calendar. However, at no point of time will I compromise on the quality of training or the quality of product or the quality of service.
And what is your priority? On what priority what priority are you deciding all this? Your quality is not compromised.
My quality remains same across the board. Okay. I decide my priorities on my 80-20 principle. Whom I need to give more priority and whom I need to give less priority.
Right? On what basis?
80-20 principle on my statistical analysis, which I do.
This is I understand, but what basis you are giving it? See, if it is not quality, if it is not other things, what basis you are prioritizing this?
I'm prioritizing
the revenue. As far as the revenue is talking about right
Mr.
now.
Mr. Chaudhary, can I talk on this aspect? In the matrix column is there, urgent, important, not urgent, most important. In the matrix four, matrix column says there. In the 80-20 principle, you have to take urgent and important where correct. You get more revenue. From the point of this is a major crux of the entire 80-20 rules.
Yes.
Urgent and important, you give top priority. That gives it 80% of the result means this is the most topmost priority where you can get more revenue for this. Other things are you can accommodate or you can adjust accordingly the need of the customer, the need of the availability of time with you. But whatever the first priority will be, urgent and most important should be top priority. That gives 80% of the result.
Okay. Yes, sir, let us carry.
Sorry. If you need, I can give you an example from a restaurant also. If revenue example, you have not understood.
Sir. Please explain. Go ahead, please. Go
ahead. Sir.
Okay, it's very simple. I run a small restaurant where I give dal, roti, sabzi, rice, everything. Now, one fine day, I start getting complaints on a phone call that, sir, today roti was burned. Somebody tells me rice had a problem. Third day dal had a problem and sometimes vegetable has a problem. I go and do a 80-20 principle and I realize that 80% of calls are coming because my rotis are burnt out or the quality of the roti is not good. Where will I focus? Where will I prioritize? I'm not saying I leave dal or rice or vegetables aside. But that is not my priority at that point of time. I'll go and catch hold of my tandoor guy and tell him that, boss, rotis are having a problem. 80% of the defects or 80% calls I'm getting for you that you are not doing your job properly. I'll have to pull him up first. He becomes my priority. Then I will see that another, or after 80%, another 15% calls are coming because my sabzi is very spicy. then that is the next aspect which I have to address. You know, this is known as targeted shooting, which one I'll target first. If I'm just getting 2% calls or 3% call, that, you know, dal was half cooked, I can address it later on also, because I'll not lose business because of that dal. But if my rotis continue to be burnt out, I'll start losing business. Does this help you? Now you understand how we prioritize?
Brother, awesome example. Appreciate it. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you. And I think one which is there on the...
Tarun.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. That is what I'm saying. The one which is there on the screen right now is a typical Pareto chart, and I think this has been made on an Excel.
Yes, but I have just taken the image right now just because we wanted to explain it. So I have taken Ishikawa also and chart also.
It can be made on Minitab also, and it is a simple principle of cumulative frequency that you go on adding it, and this is how this is also made. So I think this chart is self-explanatory. If anybody else wants to explain it, can take it ahead. I don't want to hijack the session.
go ahead, Tarun. We are here to back you up. If something gets caught up, where you get freezed up, we are there to back you up. You just start the process.
So Pareto's chart, Tarun, you want to explain? As you said that it is self-explanatory, as he rightly said. You can see that there are certain activities. There is something which is the occurrence.
Yeah, so there are problem areas. Now, this is an example from automobile. So, for example, there is a car. There are defects in steering system, emission, braking system, cooling system, ignition, other electrical, driver controls. It's being noisy. There are some miscellaneous. Usually, miscellaneous has to be the last, but that's okay. Fuel system and transmission. Now, what will you address first? You will address whichever is a major defect. So, as per this chart, if I see, transmission seems to have maximum number of defects. That 35% out of every 100 vehicles, 35 vehicles are having a problem with the transmission. So I go back to my plant, I go back to my assembly line, go and see who is working on those transmissions. Okay. Now again, there, I'll further drill down and figure it out that where is the problem? Is it manpower? Is it machine? Is it mother nature? Is it something else? I cannot recall right now. There are 5 M's. Okay. So when I say there is a defect with manpower, which means people are not skilled, do I need to train them? I see how many defects are because of manpower. If I see there are no defects because of manpower, it's probably the machine whose setting is gone for a toss. I see that. Or if that is also not there, let me see if there is a third thing. Man and machine are working in tandem. Mother nature is a problem. When I say mother nature, probably the raw material, the aluminium or the iron ore, which I am making it, where it is coming from, is defective. So if you would be knowing, McDonald's, when they make French fries, they have a specific area from where they source their potatoes. Or for example, in textile industry, amount of moisture decides the strength of the staple length of the cotton fiber. Okay, these are the impacts of Mother Nature on your product. So for example, right now Mother Nature has a, you know, we are suffering from COVID-19. Lot of things which can happen in a straight line manner are not happening because it is an impact. So man is not a problem, machine is not a problem. Mother Nature has impacted us. Or a natural calamity can change. For example, you are growing a kind of a wheat or any agricultural produce in soil. Your farmers are amazing. Your tractors are amazing. Your manure, fertilizer, everything is amazing. But because of human activities, a lot of pollution, the soil itself has got so much contaminated that 20 years back, the kind of wheat which you were producing in the field, you don't get the same kind of wheat right now. That is impact on Mother Nature. So there are 5 M's which you need to further analyze, and that is how you will go and do your correction. And you also need to understand how much variation is accepted. If it is within 3 sigma limit, it is a natural variation. If it is more than that, there is a special cause and you need to work on that cause. My hope I was able to explain the Pareto.
Yes, you are more or less very, you have explained more. I think you have a little bit of a quality control background, as the Pareto principle has many applications in quality control. And
right,
that's why you are speaking more about quality control and something which is happening in the factory setup or warehouses and all those stuff.
It happens everywhere.
Yes, it's happened everywhere. As I'm saying, it is useful for the personal individual life also. So application is everywhere. But what we have explained right now is truly, which is mostly in these kind of a setups and where the quality control check is very, very much required. So like you have spoken about restaurants, you have also spoken about small catering systems. You have spoken about the factory setup as well. So you have spoken so many things. Good examples, great examples. But yes, I don't know how much it is clear to everyone because there are very few who are discussing. I also request the other participants who are here, if you have not understood the chart, what he has explained, he was speaking about the 5 M's which was there in this Ishikawa diagram, which is also known as a fishbone diagram. It comes in picture when we analyze, when we understand what is the problem area.
Cause and effect.
What is the cause of this particular problem? So once we understand, then we do this kind of a brainstorming. And when we do the brainstorming, these are the 5 M's which Tarun is speaking about. So material, measurement, machine, method, and men. So the 5th M is the men which you are talking about, Tarun. Mm.
Yeah.
So the 5 M's are there, and they talk about if the problem area is a material, then they will go to the people exactly. who are handling the material. If yes. it is something which is related to measurements or the measures they have taken, they will speak to that gang who is responsible for that. If it is a machine problem, who all are related, they speak to that. So accordingly, they identify that from where the problem is occurring. And then according to that, they do the brainstorming that how to resolve this problem. And it is very, very useful in where we are talking about the qualitative part of any product or the services we are giving. So it's not only about the product, it is also about the services.
Exactly.
That's why I said that there are various facets on which we should discuss. So this is one facet which Tarun has given an example. Now, I want everyone to think.
Let's get back to 80-20 principle. Let's come back to our Pareto principle.
Right. Yeah. I would add on to what Swati was saying. Whatever the field you take, this Pareto principle always directs to quality only.
Absolutely.
It always directs to quality, whether it is a HR or whether it is a training, whether it is a teaching or whether it is a manufacturing.
So, Ravi sir, it is one of the tools. There are 7 QC tools, quality tools. Yeah. This is one of the tools.
Right. This is one of the tools. But 80-20, that Pareto principle always directs the maximum towards the quality of your delivery or quality of your teaching, quality of your hiring. Everything goes in that direction only.
Correct. Thank you so much.
When we are talking of application, once the cause is found out, application will follow. So, Tarun, thank you very much. At least to have given a very good light on this.
Sir, I appreciate that. Thank you.
Thank you. So, can we speak about one of the facets right now, which is very easy, where you can apply? And I think many of us are giving the trainings on customer service, which we can take as one of the example right now. And try and give input that how you will explain the application of 80-20 or Pareto's principle to your participants. Can I request the background noise? In can just unmute or sorry, mute yourself.
It is from our doctor, sir.
Okay.
You can
By the way, Pareto is very widely used in customer service. Very widely used.
Yes. Can we take customer service as one of the example right now and try and understand? Am I audible? Because I have a little audible.
Yeah. I believe Arun keep silent for a while and let others participate.
Yes, Ravi sir, that would make sense. I agree to that.
So that. They will also gain some knowledge and how to express that expression knowledge everyone should acquire. That's what the even here the quality of delivery, what I mean to say. When you deliver, your customer is attracted. Coming to customer care now.
No, though dear, today it's more of a discussion session and I have spoken about motivation initially and it should be self-motivated, I should say. You know, we all are trainers.
That's true.
So that's why I've taken one of the example right now. Customer service or customer relationship management, CRM. Let's take that as an example. Who would like to start other than Ravi and Tarun?
That is what I wanted to say.
Anyway, I'm tired of speaking now.
You take 2 minutes break, Tarun. So maybe we'll
go. Hi, this is Nikhil over here.
Yes, Nikhil.
Yeah.
Here too, 80-20 principle is being applied. Even while discussing also, it is being applied particularly by Ravi, you and Tarun.
Yeah. 80% session was taken care by 20% of the people. I really appreciate the smartness, you know. Yeah. I mean, you slapped us and we did not even get to know that we were slapped hard.
Sorry, it's not like that. Just to keep it light, and in active mode.
Beautiful.
Arun sir, I would like to add to your comment. 20% were speaking, but 80% are the, you need a target audience as well to understand your concept. So into that 80% is there, not to worry at all. There should be good listeners also into the audience who can listen to you.
that's true.
We are doing this session for helping each other, and maybe later if you take this session, it will be helpful for you and for the application of this particular topic in your area. So that's why I've spoken about that, what all areas you are giving the training and how you can relate it right now with whatever sessions you are taking. That is very important, and that's why we are doing this discussion today. Like Arun has mentioned that it can be used even in management. So that's why I have spoken about customer relationship management right now. Who would like to speak about how in CRM we can use 80-20? In CRM, anyone would like to give some input, customer relationship management? If not, then I will start.
Madam, you start, then I'll follow. Don't worry.
Okay, so customer relationship
management. I'm not an expert in it.
Customer relationship management means how the companies, like we have spoken about many brands like Amazon, we have spoken about many brands who are there in market. A brand with Tata's or lifestyle brands are there. So these brands are, reaching to the people. Any retail store, any banking retail, any insurance retail, they all are following the customer relationship management. How they are doing it is they are applying this 80-20 principle. That's how the 80% of people can be approached by the 20% of effort. So long back, I remember when even I used to work in retail, and that time this membership card has come in picture. That the club membership which has started in India, though it has started long back in other countries, but in India it arrived in, I think, somewhere in 99-2000, where it is like many of our brands have started giving the membership cards to the people. And people used to feel very proud of carrying that card with them. The Shoppers Stop has come in, like maybe the first one who has started in lifestyle retail. And, they are giving the membership card. And those who used to carry that membership card of Shoppers Stop, they used to feel very pride. Same with the airlines. Airlines also started giving these membership cards. These are also, they are providing the reward points, or they are giving some kind of a services to those people who are holding their membership. I'm not getting into the detail of a membership, but then what I want to mention here is that they are, why they have started this particular thing, why they have started giving the reward points or making members to those people who are coming in their stores. Can anyone answer this? A very simple answer I want to know.
It was mostly because just you want to retain your major customers who are giving the most of the benefits or most of the revenues to the stores or to the airlines. So this is especially being introduced particularly by the name of the privileged card that has been itself in the more.
Absolutely correct. We have taken the right word.
Privileged card.
Yes. So still it is also known as a privileged card only. Locally we call it as a membership card because people normally don't understand privilege and all. Now they are, but then initially people won't be able to understand this. So they used to call it like a Western membership card, Shoppers Stop membership card, or Global card, or lifestyle card, something like that. Or maybe
even banks have also started this priority customers.
Same the credit cards. If we talk about credit cards, you are getting cash back. Now it's not only banks. Even when we talk about the Paytm, the wallets, any other wallets, they all are giving a cashback to the people. Why they are doing it? Every place they are working on the customer relationship management, where they realize that if we retain the existing customer with us by providing some of the services, by spending only 20% of amount, but retaining our 80% of people, or those who are very regular, those who are loyal to the brand, is very, very important, are going to give us a 80% of revenue. So in every three things I said, everywhere 80% and 20% is applied. So they are targeting 20% of loyal customers to get a 80% of revenue. That's where the customer relationship management comes in picture, and they use this 80-20 principle to retain the customer and to keep them loyal for the long time. And they started giving them some kind of services. It can be a restaurant services that you can visit this restaurant and you will get 20% discount, or if you visit this particular spa, you will get some 10% discount. So they used to have some kind of a booklet, and then they are also giving some kind of a cashback. And later, after a decade, people realize that the customers are very happy when they get some kind of a discount, or either when they get some kind of a cashback. So now if you see most of the brands, they are coming up with more on, they are giving you the cashback, because people are very happy when they are getting a cashback and use that money in something else. So most of you, if you are carrying your credit cards or any other cards, if you are getting a cashback, you are always happy. Even Idea is giving, whenever you recharge, you will get 50 rupees and you can use it in the next recharge of yours. You cannot use it immediately. You can use it in the next recharge. It means they are keeping you loyal by giving such kind of a scheme. These all are coming under the CRM, and they are thinking of something or the other that how they can keep you engaged. And also they can make you loyal for the long time. Yeah, so Nikhil has raised hand in between.
Shall I start, ma'am, now?
Yeah, 1 second. So Nikhil, you want to say something? He raised his hand, and then I'll hand over it to you.
Gradually moving our management system, particularly from 80-20 to 3C principle, that is convince, confuse, and corrupt. You are getting a point.
Novi, I didn't got your point. Can you please repeat that?
We are moving from 80-20 gradually to the other concept of the management that says 3C, that is convince, confuse, and corrupt.
Mm-hmm.
So whatever cashbacks and all those things, these are basically just to encash or cashback theories. Basically, these are just to ensure that you retain your customer by corrupting them.
So that's the human behavior, Nikhil, and that's what they have studied.
Sir, repeat the middle. Convince.
You convince, confuse,
conceive.
Yeah, 3C. That is convince, confuse. You start with a convincing mode, then you go for confusion. You create some kind of confusion in the mind of customer, or if nothing works, you go for a corrupt. Awesome. That is going for a deal, discount, or cashback like of things.
Awesome.
So there are various marketing theories. He is talking about one of them, that is 3C. There are many of them actually. So CRM and the marketing actually works like that, because that's a human behavior. and human accepted. We all are, you know, happily doing all these, taking, availing all these services. Am I correct? You all are using Paytm. We all are using many other services.
Yes,
we are getting the rewards.
I was just trying to correlate particularly this 80-20 principle with that of the year. Ki haan,
right.
In what kind of things are being connected or interconnected whenever you are delivering a session, at times there are, you will get a little bit diverted to these points.
Absolutely. So Aaron also added that attract, retain and maintain. Absolutely, Aaron. So the first thing is they are attracting you by giving you some kind of a schemes or some kind of a discounts, and then they are trying to retain you with giving you more and more and discount, and they maintain it. If the maintenance is not there, it's very easy that a customer will go and move on to the next brand. I give chance to Mr. Vasudev. He is raising hand since long.
Yes, madam, I'm not a person from the sales. And I'm a civil engineer, but fundamentally I was learning yesterday a beautiful sale principle, that is spin principle.
Mm-hmm.
Into which it is mentioned, spin stands for, first S stands for situational questions.
Correct. S-P-I-N is a...
Yes. Yeah. Now here into CRM, the CRM should be very smart enough. That, supposing I'll give a beautiful example, a Sas Bow or Nanan, that is sister-in-law, daughter-in-law, and mother-in-law.
Mother-in-law.
These three are going to buy, mother-in-law, yeah. These three are going to buy a sari for daughter-in-law. Now, this salesperson or the customer relation person, he should be very smart enough. He should understand that really who is a decision maker. Among three, and he is able to visualize within 15 minutes or 10 minutes about after the some sort of a conversation, say for what occasion you need a sari, what color you need a sari, you need a silk or cotton, lot many questions he inculcates. Among this conversation between three and this one gentleman, he inculcates that mother-in-law seems to be the decision maker. Now, this is a fresh customer I'm talking about, not the old or a loyal customer. Now what happens here, he starts throwing these saris toward decision maker. Now the influencer is only the daughter-in-law. And the middle sister-in-law, Nana Bolte, she is just a recommender or a proposer. Yes, Bhabhi, this is good. Bhabhi, this is good. But decision making, wahi karne wali hai. He knows. So this customer relations also should have some sort of sense to understand that who is going to buy and who is going to give me order.
So this is actually what you are explaining is, of course, a very conventional style. Yeah, where, you know, if you go to the small shop, there is one person who is showing you saris and all that, and he always, you know, quickly understand who is the decision maker and try and who to whom they have to influence. It's the same thing happens with the kids also. When you go to the store, usually the salespeople, they attract the kids towards the product, because when they start, you know, saying that nahi chahiye, nahi chahiye, and then parents have to somehow, you know, end up buying that product. So
secondly, I would like to add something, because I think it was a learning process. Because learning, unlearn and relearn is with us. So other was like this, that it is, again, we call it cross-selling or upscaling. Upselling. So upselling, supposedly a person comes into the, say, mobile showroom and he wants to have some configuration of mobile, say 4GB RAM and 32GB hard disk or whatever they call. So he understands his strategy. Once he understands his strategy, he shows him 3 to 4 models. So these four have the similar configuration, but I would like to add you to give him the more selling. I would like to add the same pricing is this fifth one model, which I'm showing you, which has got different features, same features, but the cost is better. I mean, comparatively competitive to that. With that, you've got a headset is free, an additional charger is also free, and these four models have the warranty of, say, for example, 1 year. And this particular model has got the warranty for the 2 years. So ultimately, the customer, supposing 10,600, the basic price for all these four models, maybe 200 plus or minus variation. And this particular handset, which is promoting or marketing, it is 9,500, for example. So ultimately, that customer, now he starts with this 9,500. Once he finalizes the deal, then again, it is a CRM, this thing, you know, a duty to make him understand, sir, you'll be getting, say, 200 rupees cashback after a week. You'll be getting this voucher, gift voucher, for which you can buy apparels or something. This is again a voucher, which is again next month. So subsequently, this customer, he buys this product from the same location, same mall or multi, what do you call this, same Big Bazaar or something. And ultimately, once he is not happy with the, I'm coming the other story of this. Now he feels after 1 week, no, this is hanging. Yaar, ye toh wapas karna padega. Let me return it out. So this gentleman is calling this gentleman, but this gentleman's number is changed. It is out of network, some sort of the other, some other the problem is within the CRM and the customer. Now he, because this particular mall or whatever the Big Bazaar store is near to him, he is going personally and he's a senior citizen, 75 years age, say for example. Now the CRM, once he's entering into the mall and the first counter is of the mobiles, and he's looking here and there and you are looking at him. Oh, he has come. So you are approaching. Now you are approaching. Sir, what's the problem? So you could have called me. Oh, I was calling you. I called you 5-7 times. It was not coming resolved. This handset, I want to replace it. So he first makes him sit. Ask him a cup of water or a cup of tea or a coffee. Then he narrates, sir, we will replace it. Don't worry. It is a 2 year warranty. Oh, in case you are attached to this handset, we will send it to the technical team. Let the technical team work out. But meantime, in case you want the same handset, fine. Otherwise, I will replace this handset and we will do the things, whatever comfortable, not to worry. So this particular quality of the set, which makes an impression to this, you know, senior citizen, yaar, ye banda bahut nek hai. This gentleman is awesome. पहले तो चाय भी पिलाता है, पानी भी पिलाता है, हैंडसेट भी बदलने का भी बात करता है, नया देने का भी बात करता है. सो इन दिस पैराडाइम्स, आई थिंक वी हैड 1 week or 1 week बिफोर, ही शिफ्ट हिज पैराडाइम्स, एंड नॉट फॉर द हैंडसेट, ही शिफ्ट द पैराडाइम्स ऑफ द बाइंग एंड सेलिंग प्रोसीजर. सो हियर ऑल्सो एन इंटेलिजेंट स्मार्टनेस ऑफ दिस CRM or the sales person, whosoever it may be, it has to be, it works as a sixth sense. And ultimately, this continual process, what he does within the meantime, 1 month or 2 months or 3 months, he issues him some messages, some emails, some offers, some promotional offers. He is keeping in touch continuously until unless you don't follow up. This world is of a follow-up, I call. And this world is of opportunity. A person who never follows, he will never have an opportunity. So ensure this quality of the CRM also. I don't know whether this is again a Pareto's 80-20 principle, because he's just putting up 24% effort. Mailing him, calling him, giving him the message.
Sir, what you are talking about right now, sorry, I'm interrupting. So what you are talking about right now is more of a customer service and a customer service behavior, basically, you know, where this particular salesperson has to behave in this way that there is no loss, you know, it should always be a win-win situation. Yeah. We should not lose on the customer. And that's how the salesperson has to behave, that the person will remain loyal to the brand. And either yes, maybe he will replace the product, or if he has got that authority to do that, or if he can repair and give it to him, that is all trick. He is going to handle the customer. But when we talk about the relationship management, yeah, is more of a loyalty program, which is designed by the, which is a management basically. So it's a customer relationship management. CRM is a management. So basically they are working on all the aspects. It's not only one thing. We have taken a very few examples right now, like, you know, giving discounts or offering them some kind of a services, that also have a service called replacement, return and what we call exchange, return and refund. So these are the three things which are also there, which is a part of a CRM, right?
Yes, ma'am.
They always say that, you know, if you buy during sales, the replacement is not there. But if there is a defect, we will definitely replace the product, because there is a brand image which comes in picture. And that's why they have to work on that replacement when there is a defect which is there. The exchange is possible if there is a, you know, maybe if it is a product where related to some clothing, and also they can replace the size or anything, because there is no loss as such.
Yes.
So that's...
Madam, can you go back to Pareto 80-20 principle now?
Which one,
that
sir?
Is the basic, that what? Is the main topic. Pareto 80-20 principle.
Sir, I am into that only. I am absolutely into 80-20 principle only. And so, because Mr. Vasudev was talking about a service and I was talking about customer relationship management. So, you know, why I have taken this example, because this is very easy to understand, that how the customer, how the people, how these brands are making it 80% of how they are retaining the 80% of their customers by just investing 20% of money. How they are reaching to the customers? When you enter in the store, they are collecting your data. They are taking every information in their form. People fill it up, and the person at the counter will tell you that, you know, these are the benefits you are going to get, sir, when you take the membership. And we all are happy, because we are always waiting for, as a human behavior, we always wait for some or the other kind of a benefit. And reward points is, of course, we all love to take, because we are getting discounts in future. And that's how the people start taking, becoming a member of that particular brand. And then every time we go and say, okay, what is my point? Can I use it right now? And that is some kind of a motivation which is there, which is asking us to go back to that particular store, and which is making us loyal to that particular brand. And now what they have to do, they don't have to go to the market. They don't have to send people, their marketing team in the field, where they are saving lots of money. What they have to do is, they are taking the SMS, bulk SMS system. They are doing emailing, because they have, all the emails which are collected in these forms. They have numbers which they have collected through these forms. Now you can imagine that what is the amount they are saving by running this particular loyalty program. I'm not talking about the services what they are giving. Every brand thinks of something or the other to attract the customer. But then I'm here talking about the 80-20 only. That they are putting only 20% of effort, or 20% of investment of the money what they are spending earlier was too high. But then now, by using all these tricks, working with this loyalty management, they are saving their 80% of money and investing only 20% comparatively when they are doing. And there's another thing which is there, that, you know, they have to now, what is remaining is the 80% people. Now they are reaching by in spending 20% of money to 80% people, and the remaining 20%, they are spending the rest of the money they are spending for reaching out to the rest, where, to create a new walk-ins, or to create new loyal customers. So that's how they are managing the funds. They are saving on the funds, and they are maintaining the loyal. They are maintaining their loyal customers and retaining their loyal customers with them. Any questions still here? In between, Aisha has also raised hand. So Aisha, if you want to put some points here.
That's fine, ma'am.
Yes. Hello, everyone. This is Aisha. Well, I'm really, first of all, I would like to say thanks to everyone, because this is my, this session, Pareto's 80-20. This is my first session attending here. And I'm not into the sales, but, when I compare with the training and all, this 80-20 is a kind of real-time example I can see when we're dealing with our students. 20% of our students are very hyperactive and superactive when we deal in training, especially. At that time, if we focus on that 20% of our students, then the whole class will come in control. And the second thing is, coming to the CRM, customer relationship management, right? Correct me if I'm wrong.
Yes, you are right.
Yes. So even when I used to, my first job, when I used to work in BPO, so I was a customer, you know, I was a process associate at that time. They used to give us some talk-offs to talk with the with our clients, with our customers. At that time, that 20% of proper talk-offs used to help us a lot to get a right contact, right customer, right information. So this is really very good. And now I realize this real-time example, how effective it is. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Aisha. And I hope that the discussion helped you and will help you in future for other sessions we will conduct.
Absolutely. Thank you.
So you can see the slide right now. This is a quick examples I've taken from one of the images that, you know, a person can use it in their day-to-day life. So completing their 20% of to-do list. Now, if you are, when we were talking about prioritizing, so there also you can, you know, apply this particular principle that how you are finishing off your task, your everyday task, or your weekly task, or your monthly task. And, you know, it helps us in our day-to-day work as well, in our personal and the professional life. The second image, if you see, the focus on most of the relevant 20% of your workload, you know. So if you, something which is pressurizing you, if you just finish off that difficult 20%, then you have 80% where you have a free time available with you, or maybe an easy task which you can do little later, because you are then tension-free because you have finished your the difficult task already. You know, so that is one way of using it. Analyze the complaints of 20% of your customers. As Tarun also mentioned something similar that he was talking about, when, you know, when we know that this is the problem area, that's where that fishbone diagram has come in picture. And when we know that this is the problem area, and we settle down with this initial 20%, we will be making 80% of our customers happy. So that is one way of doing it. Assess the riskiest 20% of your business plan. Now here also, if you just, you know, if you are a businessman or if you are already running a business, you can always understand this part, that if you assess the riskiest thing already initially only in your business, then your rest of the things will always be in place. You don't have to worry about it. So the risky part, if you cover, if you manage, then the rest of the things will fall in place automatically. The last example is understand the 20% of your customers that make a bulk of your revenues, which we were discussing right now, CRM. You know, so that's how we can generate the revenues on the day-to-day basis by following the CRM or loyalty programs, which various brands are running, or even the banking sectors are running. So anywhere where in the retail they are using this loyalty program to retain their customers. Anything else anyone would like to add? So if you see this particular image, the majority of the results tend to come from the minority of the causes, right? And that's what we were discussing initially only, that applies to the multiple facets of the business. So it can be sales, it can be HR, it can be other marketing department, it can be accounts, any major department. If you just think about it right now, you will be able to, you know, connect this 80-20 principle with that. So it can be personal, it can be for the employees, it can be related to products, or it can be related to the customer. It is everywhere we can apply this 80-20 principle. You can always, you know, work on this. If you actually want to, you know, learn 80-20 principle, you can work on the Ishikawa diagram, which I have shown you here. This one, you can, you know, identify the problem, open the Ishikawa diagram, do little brainstorming, what are the occurrences, what are the causes, and then how you are going to solve it. And this is definitely going to, you know, help you to identify the problem areas and solving the problem area. Now I have actually connected it with the efficiency of everyone. So efficiency of a brand, efficiency of a person, efficiency of a particular department, efficiency of an employee. And that's why I'm ending it, the 80-20 discussion with this. Efficiency and focus are the keys of the success. If we all are in the problem areas, we will definitely will be able to be more efficient and to make it, to be efficient, we can work on this particular principle. This is one of the way we can, you know, be efficient in our personal and professional life. Can I know top five learnings of the day before we close the session quickly? A top five learning from all of you.
This is Nikhil over here.
Yes, Nikhil.
80-20 principle applies almost everywhere, whether it's personal or professional life.
That's the fourth learning you are saying. Okay, thank you so much. Only one learning we have today?
Yeah, Ravi here. This 80-20 or 20-80 principle is always applied in every nature of life in a person, whether business or entrepreneurship or training, teaching, or even your lifestyle for that matter. Day-to-day lifestyle, whether you are working or not working, even if you are a housewife, then also this 80-20 principle works here very much.
Absolutely.
There's another thing that we have learned is 20% decision making gives 80% result. I mean, 80% effort gives 20% result.
Absolutely. So, thank you so much. Yes. Correct. Okay. Anyone
20%
else?
20% of 20% of effective input gives you 80% of effective output.
Absolutely. Rightly said, Nikhil.
That is
Tarun, sorry. Anyone else? The fifth one, the last one before we close.
We have to keep the 20% intact.
20% intact.
Intact.
Okay.
Yeah, so that we can keep on yielding 80% of the result and sort it out the 20%. We must find it out where the 20% are.
Okay, and for which diagram we have worked upon for doing that quality check?
That was fishbone diagram.
Fishbone, absolutely. Thank you. Ishikawa?
Ishikawa or fishbone, yeah.
Yeah, that's another name for that. Yeah. Okay, anyone else?
Can I add something?
Sure.
Can I add something?
Yeah, sure. We will add one more hand to it to make it six fingers.
No, it's not about six fingers. It's about... See, for a Pareto analysis, the most important thing is it needs to be substantiated with data. Okay. For example, if anybody says, I have put my 20% effort and I have gotten 80% of output, how will you quantify that 20% of effort? Do you have data for it? So, whenever you do a Pareto analysis, exactly when you showed me the Pareto chart, to make that chart, you need those data points. So whether it is the input or output, there are two axes. For both, you need a tangible matrix, a tangible X and a tangible Y. If it is something like which cannot be measured, it cannot be counted either in 20 or either in 80 because it does not substantiate with data.
Absolutely correct, Tarun. I agree to that. And that will only come when you start practicing it. When we are, because we all are trainers, so I will request all of you, like, you know, after the session, whenever you get time, if you actually want to use it in your trainings or in your personal life, please think about some of the problem areas, or maybe think about in which particular field you are giving a training on the regular basis. Keep yourself in the shoe of those people, those employees or those background. Identify what are the causes or what are the problem areas they are facing and use this 80-20 principle, which is definitely going to help you whenever you go back and take their sessions. then you will, you know, help them actually to understand that these are the problem areas, this is how you should resolve it, and you should have all facts and figures in place, and you will do all the research, you know, it will be handy with you, and you can do it there itself. You can help them understand what is the practical application and how you can use it for your self-improvement, for your department improvement, or for your work improvement, and how you can prioritize. There are so many things which we keep on discussing. And, you know, so you have to start doing it, or do it once. And you have, if you find any issues, we all are there in the group. You can always discuss about it in the group as well, that this is what I have done and I'm stuck here. So what should I do? We all are there to give the input to each other and to help in learning this. And this is really, really good, you know, a principle which can be applied in various directions. Thank you so much, Tarun, for putting that point of, you know, measurement which is there. That's the only way that we can make the chart. Okay, Aryan has also mentioned in the chat box that understanding the crucial 20% in any given situation to derive 80% result is the crux of learning today. Thank you so much, Aryan, for the learning you have taken. Sanjay is saying that keep focus on top contributors, either related to business or the personal. Absolutely, that's the gist of it, you can say. Okay.
Thank you, ma'am. It was a very eye-opener. It was an eye-opener for us. And everywhere that we go, actually this 80-20 principle, we try to understand and then apply.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, everyone. We have already crossed the time of the session. So we should close. And thank you so much for participating, everyone, to be here till the end of the session. And I hope this is helpful for all of us. And we can connect for more in future.
Thank you all.
Thank you so much, Swati. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Have a nice evening. Bye-bye. This is Dr. Swati from Trainers Club.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
Thank you.